friend who is a who's also teaches meditation, he was presented with a sign that came out of a casino in Las Vegas, and it came out of one of the gaming rooms, and it, and the sign said, "You have to be present to win." Which is a very spiritual statement. Because we're into winning as much as anybody else, but it's a different kind of game. So that training the mind to focus, just to stay with the present, is really being here for our own life. And then the more that we use different meditation techniques to be able to keep the mind focused in that way, then it's like as you're able to focus the mind on the present, then we're able to understand much more clearly how life works, how what makes us tick, and how we operate as human beings. It's just like a camera. If you want to get a clear picture, you have to hold the camera steady. And so concentration is just like holding the camera steady. But then once you have the camera steady, then you can take a good, clear picture. And then examining the picture, you can see, you know, what's happening, what's there, how our life, how our world is arranged. And that's really the next element of meditation, is that quality of investigation, or the development of wisdom and insight. Like once we're able to see thoughts and feelings and moods coming and going and changing, we begin to see what pulls us towards things, what repels us, what we're afraid of, what we long for. And in that, seeing our habitual reactions, you know, chasing the pleasant, running away from the painful, having opinions about all the rest of it. And seeing our conditioned habits, then we become less caught up with them. We don't take them so seriously. Or at least if we see ourselves following conditioned patterns, we're no longer just blindly stuck with those, but we see, you know, the habits and that we have, and see how the more habitually we act, the more trouble we get ourselves into, the more of a struggle life becomes. And so in that, we seeing the difficulties we create, we tend to just naturally let go of our identification with our thoughts, our feelings, our bodies, our minds. And in that letting go of identification and holding, like grasping onto those different aspects of our world, we allow them to flow more freely, and we act from a place of wisdom, unselfishness, and kindness.
What surprised me about Buddhism was that I had thought I was a pretty okay person until I started looking at my mind and I recognized what was going on in it. And I was really rather horrified, you know, how much anger and resentment and guilt. And I remember in my first meditation course really sitting and trying to think if I had ever done one action without self-concern. And it was very difficult to find. I think I had maybe found one in my whole life. Yeah.
So. Well done.
Yeah. So that was kind of revolutionary to begin to question myself. Because always before in my life, I had questioned everything else. You know, I questioned what the government did, and I questioned what my parents did, and I questioned society, and always questioning other things. But I never questioned my own interpretation of things. I never questioned my own anger. I never questioned my own attachment, because I didn't recognize them. I just thought that this is the way you were supposed to be, and that the more attachment you had, the happier you were going to be. Because if you didn't have attachment, then you wouldn't have any ambition to do anything. So that attachment was good, it got you going in life. And anger was even better, because it prevented other people from, you know, getting in your way and taking advantage of you and stepping on your toes.
There's a tremendous relatedness, really, within most of the Buddhist traditions. In our tradition, they thought transformation, they would use things like the development of loving kindness or compassion. That is meditation techniques to develop what they call the four divine states, which is basically the sort of maturation of the emotional emotional world, so that the way in which we relate to other human beings, we can build around kindness, around compassion, around what they call sympathetic joy, mudita, which means happiness at the good fortune of others. Very, very rare commodity. So it's a sort of counterpoint to envy and jealousy. And equanimity, or serenity. So those are the four, what they call brahma-viharas, or sublime states of mind.
Yeah, Westerners tend to be, what I was saying before, kind of goal-oriented. You know, well, there's the goal of enlightenment, so I got to get this, and this is the technique, and so how am I measuring myself, you know, how far have I gotten, and how far has the guy sitting next to me gotten, you know, because I got to compete with this other meditator here. And so we very much approach meditation practice and spiritual practice like we do everything else in our life. Some kind of competitive attitude, some kind of self-judgmental thing, achievement-oriented. And then we wonder why we don't get anywhere. Yeah? Because our mind isn't changing at all. We're just seeing Dharma as another thing to master. You know, like getting your PhD. It's just another thing that you master. Whereas actual spiritual practice has a lot to do with self-acceptance.
Sight, sound, smell, taste, touch. And these are all woven together and formed into the pattern of this moment, this particular time, you know, 3 o'clock in the afternoon, 10, 10, 10. Here it is. So we might, I'm not saying, it's not like, Buddhism is not like a solipsistic philosophy, like saying the whole universe is just invented by your mind. But what we would say is the universe is experienced through the mind. So everything that we know about life and the universe and everything is known through the agency of this mind. It all happens here, right? Everything that you've ever known about your life has been known through the agency of your mind, right? Everybody would agree, yeah, these are all different aspects of experience coming into being, taking shape, and dissolving. So the faculty of wisdom is in a way the root quality of mindfulness. That's like in a way the quintessence of mindfulness is the quality of wisdom, that aware and awakened knowing of the very fabric of experience.
What's the difference? Why do we laugh when it's one person, but we don't laugh when it's the other person? Why can our anger disappear like that with one person, but not disappear so quickly with another person, when the situations are exactly the same? Okay. The answer to that question lies only in our own mind, doesn't it? How we are perceiving the situation, what we are telling ourselves about it.